द डेथ ऑफ जॉन ले कैरे, द स्टिकलर्स फॉर करेक्ट प्रोनाउंसिएशन विल पार्डन मी, आई ऑलवेज कॉल्ड हिम जॉन ले कैरे. हिज डेथ रिमाइंड्स मी ऑफ एन इंग्लिश सॉनेट विच स्टार्स लाइक डेथ बी नॉट प्राउड. दैट इज टू से दैट डेथ हैज रॉब्ड अस ऑफ ए वेरी valuable person. I would like to change that sonnet and say that in having John le Carré with him, the death will also be proud. John le Carré, who lived for 89 ripe, successful years, both as an individual and as a popular writer, and is an important writer, died at a ripe old age. And his achievement speaks for him. He wrote over 25 books, and his career as a writer was over 50 years. And he was the international best-selling author for a number of occasions. His real name was not John le Carré. His real name was David John Ronald Conwell. Personally, I would have liked him to retain the name Conwell, because my other favorite author was George Orwell, but that was also a pen name. So in a way, these two of my favorite authors, they followed the same track of taking a different name. John le Carré was born in a troubled family. His father was maverick of the negative type, and the mother was so fed up with the father that she left home at the age of 5. His father was like the absentee landlord of modern times. He was father biologically, but never father emotionally. But still, he gave his son good education. And at a very young age, David Conwell, or John le Carré as he later became, got interested in espionage. He was recruited by the MI6, which is the British intelligence service of that time, founded by a person no less than Winston Churchill. And it was the pride of England that MI6 kept an eye on the politics of the whole world. And later on, MI6 kind of developed a science of international espionage. And this science later on developed into the modern type of espionage which we witnessed during the Cold War. Now, John le Carré was recruited in this service. He worked as a spy in Germany because he knew that language. And in a very short time, this is one of the most remarkable things about him, in a very short time, he got the hang of it. Not just the hang of it, but he reached almost the soul of modern international espionage. See, espionage is an old activity. The moment one state became two, espionage started. And getting information about enemy is one type, but getting information in general about your future rivals and using that information to turn that rival either into a colleague or putting up with that rival if that country turned into an enemy, this is the modern nature of espionage. And as John le Carré grew up, he started using the experience and the information he had collected during his term in Germany, and he wrote his first successful novel, or first novel to give him a real name, The Spy Who Came In From the Cold. And this was a spy novel, but this wasn't a spy novel. The other spy novels, they were full of action. There was shooting, there were fights. Then there was no discussion, very little discussion, and absolutely no characterization. The James Bond films and the James Bond novels are an example of that, and that genre was so popular that a lot of writers started writing spy novels, but they were not spy novels, they were just fantasies. John le Carré has the credit of turning the fantastic spy novel, the James Bond-like spy novel, into a real literary classic. What's the difference? You see, people have tried to explain John le Carré's preoccupation with espionage with his childhood. But I don't agree with that. You see, a lot of houses break, but all the kids don't become spies or writers of spy stories. I think the answer lies in a statement by Ralph Waldo Emerson, who said every age has to write its books. John le Carré, because he had some experience of international espionage, the tussles, the intrigue, the conceit, deception, and then an eye on the present and the future, all this turned him into a thinker about the nature of espionage in general and the role of an individual in that business in particular. You see, if you read other spy novels, you don't remember the heroes, because all the heroes are the same. They are daredevil and they don't know defeat. And the novelist is conspiring so that they are always lucky. In the case of John le Carré, it was entirely different. You see, what is espionage? This is the first author who understood that being a spy creates an identity crisis. You are one person, but you have to present yourself as another person. Now, what kind of mindset, and doing this for a lifetime, what kind of a mindset must the spies be having? And John le Carré's writing was different in the sense that he dives or delves more into the psychology of the spy than into the action of the spy, more into the behavioral issues than just emerging as the daredevil and successful agent of his state everywhere. And then people started looking at his writing in a different way. There are very few examples when elder writers are influenced by a younger writer. John le Carré is one. See, Graham Greene was born in the first decade of the 20th century. So he was senior to le Carré by at least 20 years. But the novel, The Human Factor, by Graham Greene, is written after John le Carré's novels were published. So he looked into the individual. He looked into the psychology of that individual. And not only that, he tried to relate that identity crisis with the crisis in the business or in the duties of a spy. Later on, he added a third dimension. He created a kind of character which he calls mole. double agent. And that mole will have three personalities. His own personality, then personality of the country is spying for, and the personality of the country is spying against. And this was to some extent a new phenomenon after the Kim Philby scandal broke out in the 60s. See, Kim Philby was absolute British elite, highly educated, highly intelligent, highly eloquent, and therefore he was recruited as the British spy on Russia. And all the while, for almost 20 years, he was feeding information, secret information about United Kingdom to the Soviet Union. And this created a big crisis in the world of international espionage, and this destroyed the pride of the British Intelligence Service, which was MI6. Because they were kind of thinking themselves as infallible. But their leading agent turned out to be a double agent. So, in John le Carré's novels, this double agent or the mole, and the word has been now accepted in the English dictionary with this meaning also. The mole is very important. And to find out the mole in your own network is also espionage within espionage. Because you are spying on your own spy. And that creates a very complex situation. And novel after novel, especially in the first half of Le Carré's character, there are agents, there are activists, there are moles, and there is a towering person who is controlling all this. And therefore that novel, Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, that novel gives you four types of people engaged in the business of international espionage. And then he created two memorable characters. See, that literature is great, where people don't remember just the story, but people remember characters. And Le Carré created in the first half of his career two unforgettable characters. One is Carla, a Soviet agent, who is ruthless. I mean, ruthless will be a very mild word, who has no emotion. No act of violence, no act of cunning is foreign to him. And then his counterpart, Josh Smiley, who is a member of the... So this was Military Intelligence 5, I mean 6. John le Carré's novels have MI5. So he was a member of the MI5. And the tussle between George Smiley and Carla goes on for three novels. That is called the Smiley Trilogy, or you can call it also the Smiley Carla Trilogy, or just Carla Trilogy. And those three novels are Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, The Honorable Schoolboy, and Smiley's People. Due to some stroke of luck, Smiley's People was the first novel by John le Carré, which I happened to read. And then I went back and followed novel after novel. There is one more point about John le Carré. He had a political stand as an author. He stayed away from all state honors. He never presented his books for awards or anything. He just trusted his readers and his publishers, and he went on writing. Now, this was not just a pose. It was his ideology that a writer as a free thinker and free commentator on human life has to stay away from power, and political power in particular. He was highly critical in the latter half of his career, highly critical of the capitalist imperialist politics of the Western Bloc, namely the United States and the United Kingdom playing a secondary role in those Western capitalist imperialist designs. He criticized Salman Rushdie for that. He said that if you hurt the faith of millions, you are bound to face some repercussions for that. It's not proper to hurt the faith of millions of people, namely Muslims here, and then hide behind state protection. Now, Rushdie was also in England, John Le Carré was also in England, but look at the difference. And therefore, in the latter half of his career as a writer, see, the Cold War ended in 1989. What Ralph Waldo Emerson called our times, times changed. So later on, he started writing about the international rackets perpetuated by the capitalist countries against the underdeveloped parts of the world. And therefore, his novel, The Constant Gardener, which is also made into a film. So many of his novels have been made into film. The film of Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy is absolutely fantastic film to watch. Even as a film, it is very important. What is this novel about the Constant Gardener? It is about the medical rackets. People of the underdeveloped world using as guinea pigs to taste new medicines. And again, the husband is a member of the British diplomatic service and the wife is a voluntary worker. And she gets killed and the husband has to go through all that torture. So, Le Carré is not only a writer of spy stories. He is a master of spy stories. This is his tussle between Smiley and Carla. It is just like the tussle between Moriarty and Sherlock Holmes. So, you have to rate John Le Carré with authors like Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. He was offered the knighthood, but he refused it. And he told people, you will never hear anything like Sir John Le Carré. So this is also speaks of the character of the person. One novel of his has puzzled me for my life. And that is The Naive and Sentimental Lover. It's an entirely different novel. No obituaries have mentioned that novel. It's a huge novel. And it's a story of a platonic intimate relationship between two men. There is no sex in it, in that novel. Otherwise, it would have been a classic of gay literature. I wonder about this strange diversion or digression, let us say, from a writer who was basically interested in the business of intrigue, in the business of conceit, in the world of democracy, in the world of international politics. And he knew modern history very thoroughly. He knew history of India, he knew history of Russia, history of Europe, United Kingdom, United States, Africa. And then he was a very well documented kind of writer. He never left anything to guess. So I think that we should, and we are mourning the death of John Le Carré, but we should not belittle him as just a writer of interesting and spy stories which came very near to the classical literature. He was a classical writer. Not only that, I would like to remember him as a writer who wrote for his own times and on his own times. See, writing on the present is the most difficult part. Writing about the past is the easiest. and writing about the future is not so easy, because unless you have a vision, you can't write about the future. But writing about the present, making sense out of all the commotion around you, all the noise around you, finding the real tunes in that novel. There was this author who understood his times, he had worked in his times, and he wrote about his times fearlessly and steadfastly.